Hey guys, I'm Jody with Board Game Perspective, and today we're taking a look at Lovelace and Babbage, designed by Scott Ahms. In this 2-4 player game, you will be taking on the role of a 19th century computing pioneer, such as Charles Babbage. So, let's see how it plays. I have this game set up for 4 players with the player turn order tokens on this side, and this timer, 60-second timer, will be the first player. And then I've got the engine component tokens randomly selected in a stack next to the C, D, and E rows that will be used in future rounds. And then of course the program board with these first two rows available for the first round. Then the patron cards, a stack of those face down to start. And then each player will grab one program pad and one character, and there are 4 different characters that you can choose from. And that is the setup. So Lovelace and Babbage is played over 4 rounds, where each player will grab their program pad and will be writing down programs in these columns here, and by writing down operations and results, which correspond with these engine components on the board here. Each round is broken down into 4 phases, the first being the subroutine phase, and then you got the reset phase, which only starts in round 2, and then you have the program phase, and lastly, the resolution phase. At the start of each round, you will be doing the subroutine phase, where first, you will target a subroutine character card. So each player has their own cards, and they can look through them, see the different abilities. And they all have different numbers on the bottom as well. So you're going to choose one that you want to possibly complete during this round. Now, this card will be completed if, as you're doing the program, one of your operation results matches the number here, then this card will be completed. After targeting your subroutine, you will then choose which subroutines that you want to activate. Now, the ones you want to activate have to have been completed. So, obviously, the first round you will not be able to do that because you haven't completed any subroutines yet. Subroutines can only be activated once during a round, but you can choose as many as you want that you've completed. So if I had completed 2 in prior rounds, I could choose both of those in a round or just 1. But once they've been activated, they will be returned to the box after the round. Whichever cards you activated during the round, you can use that ability throughout the round to help you achieve special things. After the subroutine phase, you'll then do the reset phase, which is only done in rounds 2-4. Now, each column is used per round. So, at the end of the round 1, I ended with a result of 80. So, you're going to set the next program to the start value being the last end result. So I took my 80 here and I put it here to begin the second round. Now you'll also reset the turn order track, where you will place the player tokens back with also the timer back there as well. And then you'll discard any patron cards that have been placed out. You'll discard those. And then lastly, you will reveal the next round's tokens. So you will place these out on the board for the next round. Now you can only have 2 of these blue set 2 tokens per row. So if I had 3, I would have had to put a new one out there, but this is fine. Now you are ready for the program phase, where you will be writing the programs in these columns and trying to get your operation results, the numbers to equal the numbers on these patron cards or the subroutine that you have chosen. The number of patron cards that you put out depends on the number of players. So for this 4-player game, I put out 7 patron cards. As you can see, there are different symbols on these patron cards, and these correspond with this area of the program pad, where there is a column for each symbol, and whoever checks off the most boxes per symbol will get 9 points, or whoever had second most will get 4 points. After all the patron cards have been revealed, then everybody will start at the same time creating their own programs. And what you're going to be doing is creating different operation results by using these different engine components that are out on the player board. Let's go over the types of engine components. Now there are 5 different types. The first one is just basic addition and subtraction, where you will just add or subtract one and so on. The next one is multiplication and division, where you would multiply or divide by 2, and there might be some others in future rounds that come out. And the next one is swap, where you just simply switch the numbers. So a 64 would become 46. Then there is a copy, which is this one here, where this would tell you to change the number, basically copy the number. So you would copy, if it was 64, it would then become 44. And the last one is set to, and these are the blue tokens, where basically you just make your operation end result just to be 77. Let's just go over a quick example. So for this first round, everyone starts with 55. And then let's say I was trying to achieve these 3 numbers that were circled here. So what I could have done is you start with 55. I could do A2 minus, so I would choose A2 minus. So I would write A2 minus, and that would get me 53 as this end result. And then next, I would choose B3 minus. So B3 minus is minus 50. So then that gives me 3. And that was one number I was trying to go for. And then after that, I could do A4, where this is, you swap the numbers. So now instead of 3, it becomes 30. And then after that, I could do B1, B1 plus 10. So that gives me 40, and that was another number I was going for. And then lastly, I was trying to get 80, so I could do B4 times 2, and that would get me 80. Let's just go over a few little rules with the programming. So first, there is no wrapping, and that means you cannot go below 0, and you can't do anything greater than 99. Now another one is you have to round down. So if you were doing, let's do an example of 29 divided by 2. So you're gonna round down that to 14. Another one is program to claim, where players must perform an operation in a particular round in order to claim a patron card or a subroutine card that was activated. You cannot simply use this beginning number to achieve that. And also, there's a limit in number of operations. So each round there's 5, but there are a few subroutine cards that allow you to do a couple extra operations if that card was activated for that round. As everyone is programming, if someone is finished first, or say they are mostly finished but want to make sure they are first player, then that person will grab this timer and then they will flip this over, which gives every other player 60 seconds to complete. Now, as players are completing, or if they decide they want to be higher up in turn order, each person grabs the next available turn token to determine the turn order. After the programming phase is over and all of the player turn order tokens have been taken, then you will move on to the resolution phase. So first, you will be resolving each operation in player order. So for this round, I finished first and I took the first player token. So I will choose or be able to claim my rewards first. So everybody will be taking turns claiming their rewards. So since I'm first, I will choose mine first. So this 30 I circled because it matches this patron card here. So in order to claim this reward, because I'm the first one, I can choose which symbol I want to check off on my pad. So I will choose the lightning bolt. So I'm going to check off the lightning bolt here. And now the one that's available will be on the one that's upright. So this shows that now this is no longer available. So in a 3-4 player game, there might be the option where this card gets flipped over to the failed experiment side. Because, say someone after me chose this, now that would have been 2 players that have chosen the symbols here, then this gets flipped over. So if a third person chooses the number 30 as an operation result, then they will get a failed experiment, which you would check right, check it there, right here. And so this will be 1 point each. So let's say we've been around to all the different players, and now it's my turn again, and I'm going to The next one that I was going for was 29, which happens to be my character card. So I have completed that. Now, whenever you complete a character card, you will check off on your program pad the next box available. If an engine component from row C, D, or E is utilized to claim a patron influence or a subroutine card, then you will check the corresponding box. So let's say I had used one of the C engine components this round. I would check off the first available C box. And in future rounds, if I had used a D row or an E row, you would also check that as well. As you are going through and claiming rewards, if you've noticed that you've calculated something incorrectly, you do have the option of debugging. Now that is available only twice for the game, and for each one that you choose, it'll be -3 points at the end of the game. Basically what this lets you do is flip over the timer and you have 60 seconds to basically fix it. At the end of the resolution phase, you will proceed either to the next round or to in-game scoring. So after all four rounds, you proceed to the in-game scoring. And for sake of example, let's just assume that I had filled in all these programs here and this was my end result. So let's go over these first. So like I said earlier, whoever has the most of each symbol will get 9 points, and whoever has the second most will get 4 points. However, if there's a tie, you will split up those points and round down. So for this example, I had the most for this one, so I chose 9 points. This one, I was not first or second. This one, I was second, so I chose 4 points, and I add those up, and I put that here, and that's 13 points for this area. And now I also had 2 failed experiments, so I get 2 points each for that. And then I had completed 2 of my subroutine cards, so that's 4 points for that. And then I had completed or claimed a reward using the engine component from row C and row E. So that is 4 plus 1, and that is 5 points here. And then I had to debug one time. So that's gonna be -3 points. You could total all that up and that gives you 21 points. And then whoever has the most points is the winner. So there you have it. That is Lovelace and Babbage. Now, as you can tell, there's a lot of math and some programming involved, so if you don't like those two things, this is not for you. But I happen to like those things, so I enjoy this a lot. Now, I will warn you, the rule book is not the greatest. The print is really tiny, it's hard to see, it's not the best laid out. But if you can get past that and you like math, then I would definitely give this a shot. It's definitely a fun one. I enjoyed it. So if you liked what you saw today, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. And as always, thanks for watching.